Correlational research is research that measures the two variables of interest with little or no attempt to control extraneous variables, and then it assesses the relationship between those variables. Now, you know you're doing correlational research if the data is displayed like this. So this is a classic scatter plot where you have a single data point for each participant in your study, and that single data point tells you what score that participant got on both of your variables. Now, there's a couple reasons why you would want to do this type of research. First of all, it might be believed that your relationship that you're interested in is not a causal relationship. So if you have no reason to believe that there's a cause-effect kind of situation here, then you might as well just go ahead and use a correlational design. The second reason is that you might think there is a statistical like cause-effect relationship, but it's one that is beyond your ability to manipulate. Now, there's a lot of reasons why you wouldn't be able to manipulate a variable. It might be unethical, it might be unfeasible, or it might be literally impossible. But if for any reason you think that that's just beyond your capabilities, then the best you'll be able to do in that case would be a correlational design. Now, when you do go to collect data for a correlational study, it doesn't really matter how or where the variables are measured. Like, you could go out to a shopping mall and just, you know, talk to people who are walking by about their attitudes, about shopping habits and whatever. So all I'm saying is, correlational research is really adaptable in that way. Like, you could do this kind of research in any type of environment. And the most common way that people do it is in the form of a naturalistic observation, archival research, and survey research. So those are the top three methods. Now, if you want to do a naturalistic observation, it's pretty easy and straightforward to do. You simply go out into the real world and you observe people's behavior in the environment in which it typically occurs. So if you want to learn more about students, go hang out at a college. If you want to learn more about trendy people, I don't know, go hang out at a Starbucks or something. I don't know what trendy people do nowadays. You get the idea. You just want to go to the places that these people tend to go to and watch what they do. So there's some strengths and weaknesses to this design. The strengths are that you're observing this behavior in the real world. So we know that it's real. You know, we know that this isn't just some strange laboratory result. It's something that actually does happen. And it's also a useful way to study non-manipulated behaviors, just like spontaneous behaviors, behaviors that people engage in naturally. But the weaknesses are that it can be very time-consuming. While you're camped out at the shopping mall for hours and hours, just waiting for somebody to walk by and do something interesting, you might realize that you are incredibly bored. That's how it tends to go with a lot of naturalistic observations, is you tend to lose focus, and that can be a really big problem. If you can't focus on your task, then the data collection is not going to be very good. So, yeah, it's not very efficient in that sense. Another big weakness is that there's a potential for observer influence. Remember, if you go to that shopping mall to observe people, they're going to be observing you too. They'll notice that some weirdo is sitting by the side of the wall taking notes about everybody walking by, and they might act differently in reaction to your presence. And then the third big problem is that any data you collect, any observations that you make and you write about, they are inherently subjective. So you might not see things, you might not notice things that a different observer would. And it's that subjectivity that really, really like damages the credibility of a lot of these kinds of reports. So naturalistic observation, while it is popular and it is relatively easy to do, it does have some pretty big flaws. But there have been some classic studies using the naturalistic observation design that have been profoundly influential. For example, researchers Levine and Noren Zion used a naturalistic observational design to study differences in what was termed the pace of life across countries. And what they found, they traveled around the world to these different countries and watched people. What they found was that people in some countries walked reliably faster than people in other countries. So in the United States and Japan, people covered 60 feet in about 12 seconds on average, while people in Brazil and Romania took close to 17 seconds to, pass that 60-foot mark. So what we can conclude from research like this is that there are some interesting differences on just like normal everyday life between these different countries, and maybe those differences reflect a cultural mindset. This is some really neat stuff to think about, and a lot of these naturalistic design studies, they serve as a catalyst for a whole new field of exploration. But as I said, they've got some problems. Observational studies are always going to be a bit chaotic. All kinds of stuff can happen. It might be that you have a sampling problem where you just don't know the best place to go. You don't know the best people to collect data from, or under what conditions you should collect that data. Like, should you go to the shopping mall in the middle of the day, or should you go later at night? Should you go when they're busier, or where should you be exactly? There's a lot of details like that that you need to work out. But basically, you need to decide who you're going to observe and under what conditions. The second big problem with observational research is that you're going to have to decide exactly how you're going to collect your data, how you're going to conduct your measurements of behavior. So, to be precise, what behaviors do you want to look for, and how are you going to record them? If, for example, you wanted to record how happy people are, maybe you could look to see how long they smile or how often they smile, or maybe you could look for other behavioral features related to happiness. These are all decisions you're going to have to make before you even get started. So it can be quite difficult to make those decisions, but it's important that you do before you get started so that you can develop a system that we call coding. Now, coding is a form of measurement that involves clearly defining a set of target behaviors and then categorizing participants individually in terms of which behavior they have engaged in and the number of times they've engaged in each behavior. So the duration of each behavior could be recorded as part of that code, and the target behaviors must be defined in such a way that no matter who does the observations, they will very likely code them in the same way. So this is something I mentioned in a previous video, iterator reliability. So it's just very important that this code can be used by anyone. And the only real way you can make sure that your code is working properly is to test it out. So get numerous raters, give them this coding procedure you've developed, and have them all, code the same thing. Like maybe you could show them a video and just have them code it using this procedure just to see if they are all coming to the same conclusion. Because obviously you want this to be a reliable procedure. Now, one of the major concerns that I mentioned before is that your presence when you're out there, stalking people, basically, is that you might influence them. So, or you might just make them uncomfortable. So when you're doing observational research, you just need to have that kind of thing in mind. Like, generally, observational research is going to be considered acceptable if the participants are completely anonymous, so you're not collecting anybody's names and you're not recording their faces or their speech, and the behavior that they're performing is in a public setting where people would not normally expect any degree of privacy. So if, for example, you go to a grocery store and you start interviewing people, that's a little weird, but they shouldn't expect to be private in such a setting. You know, a grocery store is a public place, so it's perfectly fine if you want to talk to people and creepily look at people from across the room. Just don't start a fight. You don't want to antagonize people. So you do need to use discretion. Even in some public places, it can still be problematic. Like, there are certain environments that I'm sure you're well aware of. You know, we have these social norms for which environments are okay to approach somebody else and which ones aren't. Like, for example, you should never approach somebody in the middle of the parking lot. That's just all levels of creepy. You don't know what's going to go down in a parking lot. So just wait for them to, you know, get onto a sidewalk or enter a store or something. Another one is, even though a bathroom is technically a public place, you don't want to talk to people in the bathroom. I don't know what it's like in the female's bathroom, but when people try to talk to me in the male's bathroom, it's just all kinds of creepy. So just all I'm saying is try to use some discretion. Use some common sense. And some of the best things you can do is to just not approach people at all. Just try to kind of blend in, try to hide. You know, there's two ways that you could do this. You could literally hide. You know, you could literally jump in a bush and just watch people from the bushes, or sit in a dark corner where nobody's likely to notice you. And that's actually a really good idea. If you can conceal yourself so that no one knows you're there, then your presence should not disturb them. It should not influence them, so you'll get better recordings of your measurements. A lot of researchers doing observational studies, they tend to use security cameras or one-way mirrors or things of that nature to conceal their presence. But there's another technique you could use when it's not really feasible to hide yourself. What you could do is take advantage of what's called habituation by hiding in plain sight. You know, this is where a person just kind of sits in the back and doesn't draw attention to themselves. Others might notice them at first, but if that individual is just quiet and doesn't call any attention to themselves, then they'll just kind of blend in and fade away. You know, like they turn into a wallflower and just kind of camouflage against this background of whatever the environment might be. So habituation is a real psychological phenomenon where repeated exposure or constant exposure to a stimulus will result in that stimulus no longer being noticed. Now, another kind of research besides just the standard type of, you know, naturalistic observational research that you could do is called archival. So with archival research, what you're doing is testing new hypotheses using data that has already been collected. Like, maybe your research question could be best answered by simply looking at the USA Census data. If that's the case, then they've done all the data collection for you. You can skip that part because you're doing archival research now. So a lot of the times archival research will take advantage of these huge databases that are publicly available, but sometimes they'll take the form of what's called a content analysis. So this refers to a wide family of approaches to measuring things using a complex archival data, which often involves measuring the occurrence of specific events in media. Like, maybe you want to study culture and you want to see how often people in the 1980s were talking about a particular subject. I don't know, like something to do with political opinions. So you could go back, collect a lot of those old video recordings and start going through them systematically and just taking note of all the times that the particular political opinion that you're interested in is discussed or at least mentioned. So that can be a great way to just get a sense of what people were thinking about and what people were talking about at that point in history. And we could do that nowadays too by just looking at the internet, looking at the kind of content that's published on like Twitter or YouTube or whatever, and just seeing what topics are trending, for example. So that's a content analysis. Now, when you're doing this kind of research, there are certain rules you'll need to follow. And these are basically the same rules as doing a naturalistic observation. Step one, make sure you establish those basic behavioral categories you're going to be looking for. So what are the important terms? What are the important behaviors that you're interested in? Step two is to use a frequency method or a duration method or some kind of interval method for obtaining scores. So in other words, are you going to be counting how often something is mentioned or how long that behavior occurs or whatever? You just need to make those kinds of decisions. And then step three, you want to employ multiple observers for at least part of this measurement process to make sure that your coding procedure is working properly. So this goes back to that inter-rater reliability that I mentioned earlier. But to make a long story short, archival research really isn't all that different from doing observational research. You're just, instead of going out into the real world and looking at people, you're going onto the internet and you're looking at recordings of people. That's basically the only real difference. You're just using somebody else's collected data. But survey research is very different. Survey research is a quantitative approach that has two important characteristics to it: self-report and large samples. Now, the goal of doing a survey is to get like a snapshot of a particular group at a particular time. I mentioned in the previous example of archival research, you can do this to kind of get a sense of what people were talking about at a point in time in history. Well, survey research has the same kind of goal. You know, we want to collect data from a large number of people on some topic and just see what most people feel about that topic. Survey research is commonly done in all kinds of situations, but I'm sure you're most familiar with it due to our politics. We have a lot of political polling going on pretty much all the time to see who people want to vote for and people's opinions on various, policies and measures and things. So survey research is incredibly popular in those kinds of fields, and just most fields in general. Now, surveys are commonly used by political parties, but also companies who want, for example, accurate descriptions of what their customers are like and what their customers prefer. I'm sure you yourself have completed many surveys if you ever shop online. It's quite common for these websites to email you a link that says, "Hey, please, if you have a few minutes, take our survey." So that's exactly what I mean. They're just trying to learn more about the people who come to their website so that they can create a better website, a better internet ex shopping experience for their customers. And if you ever do respond to one of these emails, then you are what we would call a respondent. That's the technical term for somebody who completes a survey.